Okay, how y'all doing? What we're going to be doing today is making a simple horizontal coil build for a Kanger Subtank RBA that's we're actually going to be putting into a knee box, one of these little convenient devices. Of which I have two, and we're going to be using platinum wire, 95% platinum, 5% ruthenium. That's one of the more common alloys that you see, because it's a little bit stronger and easier to work with. So PT950, which basically means 95% platinum, the 5% could be rhodium or iridium, but ruthenium is what you most commonly see here in the United States. Alright, so I had cut a 3-inch length of wire and had coiled it, and then kind of bungled the my first take of this video, but that's all right, because what I'm going to show here is there's the coil, 3 millimeter diameter coil, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to show how easy it is to work with. What I'm going to do is I'm going to just simply unwind this with my fingers. And so without any how many tools needed? There we go. Now the purpose of using platinum is because it is an element that will not react or oxidize with anything at normal atmospheric conditions, at any temperature. Gold has the same property. My first experiment was with actually a gold wire. The resistance of gold is so low, it's lower than nickel, or around the same as Ni-200, and even more of a pain in the ass to work with than nickel, because you need to use 30 gauge wire, and it's extremely soft, and you know, with 30 gauge wire you're still getting like 14 wraps, and just the way it heated up was kind of mediocre, and you know, it didn't tarnish at all throughout use. So well, there had to be something better, and I think this is it. And so I've been building platinum coils for the past month or so, and finding them to be very, I don't really see any downsides, other than arguably the cost. It wholesales, the wholesale price, not necessarily the wholesale price, is about $4 an inch. So we're not talking an inexpensive wire. But if you see my other videos, you'll see that no matter how gunked up they get, no matter how, if you just burn the hell out of them, it takes about 5 seconds, 10 seconds maybe of dry firing the coil, and then it returns to this untarnished, shiny, silvery state. Basically becomes brand new again. So effectively, you could install a coil into a deck, a platinum coil, and never need to recoil it again. You just have to re-wick it whenever you felt like. All right. Just gonna use this winder, and now this is soft enough that the at this rotating part, don't even bother with it. It's not even necessary. So, there's several pieces of platinum wire that I have wound and rewound several times, usually sort of experimenting with the different diameters. Now, a platinum, because no oxide forms on the outside surface, it does not work as a contact coil. It will short. However, because it's so easy to work with, not really the when we wrap it, we can squeeze all the coils together, and I'll demonstrate. It's very, very simple to dress up the coils and clean everything up and make everything tidy, and so that it's properly spaced. And we don't even need to we don't even need to glow the coil. I do it with my fingernails. Which, for a thicker 24 gauge wire, that's pretty impressive. And so there we go. And let's go ahead and look at the deck. All right. Now, to do the RBA build on a for a knee box, you're actually going to need a sub-ohm tank bottom, which you can get by buying a sub-ohm tank and using the bottom as a base to build on, or it's available as a spare part, which is how I got this one. Although I do also own a Subtank. I just want to get this kink out. As is the case with building coils, ultimately how long it takes you to build depends on how OCD you are. I'm going to do a reasonably clean build because this is going up on the web. All right, that should right in. I forgot to mention, so I pre-cut 3 inches of wire, And as you noticed, I wound it in such a way that there's no waste. With the cost of this wire, it's not one that you want to, just cut an arbitrary length and then, and then trim the ends as you normally would do. This is not actually as much as of a handicap as you might think, because the resistance of a wire depends on the length. So basically, you can figure out what resistance you're kind of shooting for, and you need to stick this in here. And then cut a length of wire that's going to match that. And then that way you can then build the coil such that you get your resistance and you don't have any waste. And so I had been cutting 4-inch lengths of wire, which when new would amount to 0.2 ohms. And then as it would break in and overuse, would drop down to 0.18. And this is just a single coil, so we can go a little bit lower in resistance. So this one got a 3. This one got 3 inches. All right, that looks pretty good. All I have to do is make sure it doesn't touch, but there doesn't have to be, massively wide spaces in between each coil. So actually I hold that with my fingernail and then just kind of stretch. Need to make sure that this has the correct height. That's definitely usable. I mean, you can sit here and tweak as much as you feel like, I guess. But, all right, let's check the terminals one more time, make sure, and see what that comes out to, which is 0.09. All right. And let's run our first first dry fire test. And here, obviously, we're doing what you normally do with any coil, which is to see if it heats from the inside out. And actually, this one seemed to be a little bit tight. And now let's try that again. There we go. Very nicely starts from the center and then comes on out. Will that come back in focus? Hello. Now, it's not as a interesting counterpoint. To look at the rate at how it heats. If you see this, it'll just bam. It just gets blindingly red hot, almost instantaneously. And so what I have here, that's a 24 gauge titanium. Same type of deck. The baseboard is a little loose. I'm gonna spread the ohms. 0.9 did seem a little low. So as a point of comparison, let's see how that heats. A little bit more progressive. And I'm going to be throwing this away because, as you can see, there's white that has formed on the coil, which is titanium oxide, which is toxic. And titanium is great. It's you have to be very careful about how much you heat it. All right, where are you stuck? See there if it'll actually focus. Yeah, turn white. That's unusable. The base being a little loose, a red low. That's 0.12, which is actually more of what I was shooting for. I wanted to keep it above 0.1 so that I have the option of running it in either temperature control mode or power mode. All right. This one, real quick. Dry fire test. Separate that, maybe bring that a little bit closer. There we go. Very evenly goes from inside out. All right. Now we're going to wick. Here's the cap that goes over, and those are the juice holes, which I have bored out to 4.1 millimeters. Any coil setup that's just very thirsty, there isn't a whole lot you can do except increase the juice flow. And I've struggled with this in terms of trying all the different types of wicking, and I could just never get enough juice to go. So this is Japanese Kojendo cotton, which I have already cut and sort of stretched out. You want the fibers to be all straight. What I'm doing, let me see here. I'm placed on the palm of my hand, and I think a guy on YouTube called this the sushi roll. It's just a faster way of doing a Scottish roll. For some reason, Scottish rolls I could just never really get working right. Let's see if this one. It just seemed a little bit too loose for my taste. It's a little loose. And what I have, I could cut another one. It's a pain in the butt. What I do is, the top and bottom layers, which are commonly peeled off, I actually save those, and if it's just a little bit too a little bit too thin for comfort, then I'll just add that to the outside to thicken things up a little bit. Let's try this again. Let's add one more of those. It's not coming through the camera. It's totally see-through. It's a very, very thin layer. The other purpose I keep this stuff around is that it's good for adding clouds to the bottom of a RDA deck. I'm doing that wicking. All right. Now, if it's totally not, totally not snug, it's not the end of the world. These things expand quite a bit once they. Yeah, you know what? That's good enough. When they get wet, and furthermore. The thicker the juice that you're using, and there's only one juice that I use, which is EpiClouds Max VG. So pretty thick stuff. So we don't want it to be too tight. Definitely in that sort of situation. Okay, and I've tried every wicking technique that I could find on YouTube to make this work, and none of them would work quite right. So until I came up. I don't know if I came up with it or if I saw someone doing it on a different tank and thought, you know, if it works on that, it should work on this. So I don't know if you can clearly see what I'm doing here, but I'm just having the wick pass right through this one. We're gonna have to with that end as well. There we go. Let's get that tightened down. I there's that pancake method works for some, didn't work for me. Everything else I just couldn't do it, but this where the wick just goes straight through and all the fibers are going in this direction, that one worked. So the only thing we have to make sure is that when we trim the ends, if you can see there, leave a little bit, maybe about a millimeter or two, because we're gonna fluff that out and make sure that it covers the hole completely. Sort of fluff it out. Oh, we put the cap on. Let's check the resistance again. Let's make sure. Sometimes I don't cut the lead short enough, and then they will. If the positive touches the outer cylinder, then it'll short or read really, really, really low. And I'm like wondering what the hell happened. So we're juicing the outside here and sort of spreading it out so it's, to ensure that it's a solid plug. Doing the same thing over here. And then, we'll go ahead and prime the rest of the wick here. And, let's give this a little, everything's working. Add a little bit more there. Screw the cap on. Alright. And we are now finished with the build. And we don't need that base anymore, and we're done with this. Alright, this one, the juice level, it's pretty much full, but any of you have one of these incredibly convenient devices, we can change coil and without having to empty the juice, so it's on, and that's not focusing either. Okay. What I like to do is I leave it on, unscrew the base, and then I try and fire it, and then it. You get a blinking 9.99 ohms, which basically says it doesn't detect an atomizer. That is a nickel SSOCC, which as far as nickel coils go, actually I'd say it's pretty much as good as it gets. But some people can't. I can very definitely, distinctively taste nickel wire. Okay, so screw the RBA deck into the base. And then let's top off the tank while I add it. Supposed to stop at that little ledge, but I like to live dangerously. I'll go a little bit further past that. I'm also one of those idiots at the gas station who, when the tank is full, like I sit there and I try and squeeze in like 2 more cents. Over and over, wet these ends again, then ease that in there, screwing, if it's a old load or new load, it is a new load. And it's this one's reading 0.14 ohms. The chip in this thing is not the most accurate thing in the world, and that's kind of an understatement, but it works, and as long as you work with it and try not to go off of what you know, or this isn't 300 degrees or whatever, you can find the sweet spot that you're looking for. Now, this has a nickel temperature control that works very well. Although the temperature that this has is it's got to be way off. and it has a titanium mode, which just does not work with titanium coils. I spent a lot of time getting frustrated with that. Obviously, these didn't come with a platinum mode, what we're gonna do is we're gonna switch to the titanium mode, and because I found on a few devices that the titanium mode, the TCRs that's most commonly programmed for it, they also work with this pretty decently. Like this IPVD3 is also running in titanium mode. This one's running dual platinum coils, and you just have to start from the very bottom and work your way up. I never even, never even adjusted the temperature, which is at 212, and then I just bumped the joules up until I got to where I was satisfied. Yeah, I needed that. So on this, we're going to do the same thing. It was previously set at 50 watts. From experimenting with the other Nebox, you want it at... we're going to start at 20 watts. And the temperature we're going to have at 205. So let's see how this goes. Well, it was pretty spot on straight away. So, yep. So there you go. That is a complete platinum wire RBA build for the Nebox, and then also how to set it up for temp control. Platinum coils also work well in power mode, but they gunk up quicker. If you can run them in temperature control mode, that's ideal. And I hope you found this informative. I'm never gonna have to buy coils for either of these again. I'm just gonna pull the deck out, pull the wick out, dry fire it, re-wick it, stick it back in. Platinum, just every time you dry fire it, it returns to new. So I've got a stash of SSOCC coils that I have to find new homes for. Anyways, thank you for watching, and I hope this didn't go too long. Where's my mouse? Yeah, this did go kind of long. All right. Anyways, platinum wire coils is the future. People are saying stainless steel is a game changer, I certainly like it. Here is a roll of 24 gauge SS316L, and it's as pretty much as easy to work with your hands as platinum, but where is an example here? Here's a test coil I did with stainless, and I actually haven't vaped this. I just did the coil, found out that does contact coils just fine. And then I dry fired the hell out of it, and it's this kind of rusty color, and that just doesn't happen with platinum. And platinum has no taste, which actually tastes weird at first, because the taste of a wire is part of the combination. Of anything the cotton is imparting to the flavor, as well as the juice that you're using, you're also tasting the wire. And then by taking the wire out of the equation, by not being able to taste the wire, at first it's kind of it seems a bit odd. But then you get used to it, and then you begin to appreciate the fact that you can, once the cotton has sort of really broken in, that you can really taste what the juice that you have actually tastes like, or is supposed to taste like. I'm online in various different places. I'm preaching the virtues of platinum wire. Yes, it is expensive, but you only buy it once. Whereas, with a Canthal coil, you use it and use it as long as you can put up with all the gunk and the blackening before you wind a new one. And so, this is it the most, it's not the cheapest way to vape, but it's certainly, in my opinion, the best coil wire option that is available at this time. It has all the benefits of the new ceramic heating elements that just came out this month. Is it as in that you can dry burn them and reuse them over and over. But as you could see, the ramp up times, if it's not on a on an uncontrolled unregulated device, it it ramps so fast. Platinum goes hotter, faster than any other wire that I've ever seen. So there's no waiting around for your nice warm vape. And I hope you have a good one. And as you can see from the stickers on my mods, if you ride a motorcycle, you should be riding a Ducati. Okay, thank you very much for your time and your patience with my long-windedness and also my camera that can't focus worth a damn. Okay, peace out.